In a league where linear player development is so often expected, Royce O'Neale is a unique exception. Quite the opposite of Pat Riley's disease of more that commonly plagues young players, O'Neale identified the strongest area of his game early on and narrowed his intense focus on these areas. This allowed him to not only find his niche in the NBA, but become a primary glue guy for the Utah Jazz. Like with any young guy, finding that niche meant establishing his foundational skills. For O'Neale, that's defense, specifically defense on bigger wings. Quinn Snyder put him on New York's Julius Randle a few games back, someone who, per basketball reference data, O'Neale gives up 4 inches and 25 pounds to, and frankly, that feels like an understatement, with Randle known as one of the league's strongest guys down low. O'Neale was right at home in his element. As this clip begins, he's already jostling with Randle in the post. Watch him front and recover with nothing but his feet and chest alone, keeping his hands high to prevent both a foul and the entry pass. He torpedoes this play by himself, and then still makes the effort to muscle up on Randle for the box out. Here's a different Randle post up with the ball already entered. O'Neale is setting him up for something here. Watch carefully as Royce absorbs the first bump from Randle's chest. What he's setting up for is called pulling the chair. As Randle leans into his next attempted contact, expecting O'Neale's chest to meet him, Royce takes a big step back with his hands held high. Suddenly, there's no chest contact. Randle is off balance, and O'Neale blocks a bigger player while barely jumping. Here's another of those same chair pulls to nearly force a turnover, but Randle's really good, so he recovers and makes the shot regardless. On top of being a physical beast for his size, O'Neale is incredibly intelligent defensively. Let's pause this one here and do a quick quiz. Can you guess the primary option for the Knicks on this play? If you guessed Randle, thank you for paying attention. The goal here is for Randle to take this pick from Alec Burks and sprint into low post position on the left block, but Royce sees it ahead of time. Where some guys would take an extra beat around a pick that wasn't close to the ball, O'Neale sprints through it and cuts off the planned action. That's not the only bigger guy O'Neale has caused problems for. He's historically done well against Kawhi Leonard, for instance. Watch him here, sticking with one of the strongest wings in the league, absorbing Kawhi's shoulder push at the rim to get a contest up and force a miss. Matchup data from NBA.com shows the gap between Royce defending opposing forwards compared to guards. This data isn't perfect, but over a large sample like the entirety of last season, a 7-point gap in field goal percentage allowed is significant. Combined with some close observation, there's little doubt O'Neale's optimal defensive role is facing bigger wings. And to Snyder's credit, he seems to have realized as much. The share of time O'Neale has spent on opposing forwards has gone up each of the last 2 years. Quinn still seems to have his preferences in certain spots, Jamal Murray comes to mind for instance, but overall he's put Royce in more and more optimal positions. Here are some other examples against both Kawhi and Giannis.
Get it up and over him. Off ball, you don't see him coming the majority of the time.
O'Neale's other foundational skill is spot-up three-point shooting, something we don't even need to show the film of. If you've watched the Jazz at all the last few years, you know Royce is a knockdown guy. He's above 40% on all catch-and-shoot threes since the 18-19 season, per Second Spectrum data, an elite number throughout the league. As a quick aside, Seth Partnow of The Athletic was kind enough to pull a stat for me. Per his research, just a tick under 90% of Royce's three-point attempts have come uncontested for his entire career. That's the single highest number in tracking data history, going all the way back to 2013-14, among guys who have taken at least 200 threes. This means O'Neale never shoots it when it isn't specifically his job to shoot. Let's keep that one tucked away for just a moment. O'Neale established his 3-and-D chops pretty much immediately in the NBA, which brings us back to our theme from the top of the video. The comparison would be ludicrous today, of course, but it's interesting to look back at Royce versus Paul George in their respective rookie seasons. They weren't identical, of course, but there were some definite similarities in the way they were used. Both were primarily 3-and-D specialists, building in an extra layer here or there. Since their rookie years, of course, their paths have diverged completely. George, a top 10 pick, naturally added several pieces to his game and is among the top two-way wings in the world. Shots like these are for guys like him, not guys like Royce. O'Neale took the much less glamorous road. He consolidated his game, zeroing in on the stuff he's best at while shedding almost everything else. He realized early on in his career that he wouldn't be a ball-in-hand scorer on a roster that already had several, so rather than muck things up, he didn't even try. O'Neale's usage percentage, or the percentage of Utah's offensive plays he used via a shot, free throw, turnover, or assist, has declined every season he's been in the league. Meanwhile, his points scored per shot attempt has risen, not in quite as linear a way, but with a pretty clear trend line. O'Neale obviously does stuff besides defend and shoot, and you can find his game's evolution there. He's always been a good rebounder based on his effort level and anticipation, for instance, and it seems like Snyder is nudging him toward being more aggressive on the offensive glass this year. Royce spends lots of his time in the corners offensively, and he has to make quick reads on whether to attack the boards or retreat. As this shot is going up, he scans the floor and sees multiple teammates above the free throw line extended, available to backpedal on defense. Plus, his own defender isn't paying attention to him, so he darts in, does his usual work harder than the opponent thing, and the Jazz get an extra possession. Here's another one of those, with Royce so far in the right corner you can't even see him. It's the same calculus as the shot goes up. Four Jazz players back behind the play, so O'Neale can go nuts on the board. I don't have any data to back it up, but I'm confident O'Neale is one of those guys who tracks rebounds in the air really well. As he's crashing here, you'll see him change his path when he sees the shot coming up short, allowing him to tip the board out to a teammate. Sometimes it's just pure effort. O'Neale grabs his own board here off the late clock miss, then simply beasts his man on the baseline, goes up for a putback. Luka Doncic had some comments about the Mavs' effort level after two straight losses to the Jazz. Let's just say I hope he was including himself in the criticism, because Royce makes him look bad here, and a few times. Look where they both are when this shot is in the air. This is the best you've got, Luka? Yikes. O'Neale is rebounding just under 4% of Jazz misses, easily the highest number of his career and above average for someone his size. He doesn't get the credit for the Jazz's second best offensive rebounding number in the NBA, which is obviously for Rudy Gobert and Derek Favors, but Utah does perform a bit better there when he plays versus sits, and I think he's making a difference. Another area I think Snyder's been in O'Neale's ear about is utilizing his speed in transition. Royce is really fast, and also isn't the first guy most defenses are trying to find when the Jazz are out on the break, which leaves him available for plays like these.
Give it to Clarkson, back to Joe. Lob it up, put it down! Joe Ingles, what a beautiful pass on the hands of O'Neale.
Again, Luka, what would you say you're doing here?
To Conley, he'll lob it to Royce again! And the Jazz are running Dallas out of the house.
It's not just lazy defense allowing O'Neale easy hoops either. The Royce of years past definitely slows this play down, but with speed and an open floor to dribble in, he confidently attacks the rim here for two.
Favors grabs his fifth rebound. He's played 10 minutes thus far. Royce O'Neale muscles home two.
The Jazz are the best transition offense in the league by a lot, and their numbers peak with O'Neale on the floor. They score an absurd 151 points per 100 chances on the break when he plays, nearly 25 points higher than when he sits. Again, even if there's some basic variance at play here, and there probably is, basic observation supports the theory that he's a positive cog in the transition machine for the Jazz. Being active in transition has also allowed O'Neale to stay involved as a passer. He's about to make a really nice little drop-off to Derek Favors for a dunk after his sprint contorts the defense.
Late here in the first, pass it off, nice pass. Beautifully done, a little bang-bang play.
On this next one, Donovan Mitchell's pass is about to be way too high for Royce in transition. But the Jazz have their transition O down to perfection, and O'Neale knows exactly where Jordan Clarkson will be in the corner, so he doesn't panic here at all.
Lobs toward O'Neale, makes the catch now, it's Clarkson, he's wide open.
The confidence is spilling over into O'Neale's half-court game. Look at this little pass here. Donovan Mitchell looks surprised to be so open. The defense definitely was. It's not easy to develop the way Royce O'Neale has in the NBA. There's a reason most guys want to add skills and do more as they age. That often keeps you in the league. But plenty of guys take that too far, sometimes at the behest of overly optimistic coaching staffs. But the marriage between the Jazz's staff and O'Neale has been perfect, and O'Neale's ability to hone in on his best traits, all while improving around the margins, is why he's a rotation fixture for one of the best teams in the league. Thanks to everyone for your support. If you'd be willing, please recommend me to anyone you know who might enjoy Jazz Film Room as we try to build this community.